Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Lady of Sing Sing, an American countess, an Italian immigrant, and their epic battle for justice in New York's Gilded Age, by Idanna Pucci. Read by Lisa Flanagan with the author. To Edgar Morin, a rare sage with universal vision. To Terence, whose presence beside me transforms the most strenuous task into a poetic experience. Vedrassi li abere delle gran selve di Taurus e di Sinai, Apennino e tala scorrere per l'aria da oriente a occidente, da aquilone a meridie, e portarne per l'aria gran moltitudine e domini. O quanti voti! O quanti morti, o quanta separazion d'amici e di parenti, o quanti fien quali che non rivedranno più le lo provincie né le lo patrie, e che moran senza sepoltura, con le loro ossa sparse in diversi siti del mondo. The trees of the vast forests of Taurus and of Sinai, of the Apennines and of Atlas, shall be seen speeding by means of the air from east to west, and from north to south, and transporting by means of the air a great quantity of men. Oh, how many vows, how many deaths, what partings between friends and relatives shall there be! How many who shall never more behold their own lands or their native country, and shall die unsepulchred, and their bones be scattered in diverse parts of the world. Leonardo da Vinci, Prophecies of Sailing in Ships. De lo que fui no tengo sino estas marcas crueles, porque aquellos dolores confirman mi existencia. Of all that I was, I bear only these cruel scars, because those griefs confirm my existence. Pablo Neruda. No hay pura luz. Foreword by Edgar Morin. This powerful narrative plunges us into the tragic odysseys of impoverished 19th-century peasants from southern Italy, who were catapulted into New York, the most modern city in the world. Among the teeming crowds was an illiterate 20-year-old woman who carried with her all that she owned, her sense of honor. This hidden history unfolds like a thriller because of suspenseful details about a distant epoch when issues that still haunt our society were being faced for the first time. In American courtrooms, we watch the young sweatshop seamstress who stands accused yet understands nothing of the charges against her, or even her defense. She will be the first woman convicted to die in the newly invented electric chair. We follow the courageous campaign of a daring American activist married to an Italian aristocrat as she races against the clock to block the execution and win an appeal for a new fair trial. During this story, we also enter the labyrinth of Little Italy in 1895, and particularly upsettingly, we delve into the psychological, moral, and cultural transformation of a young woman who has been deeply scarred by her dishonor, betrayed by a man who abused and mocked her. This dramatic journey makes us ponder immigration, violence against women, corporate excess, social inequality, justice, prison, and death. All civilizations must rise above retaliation, which in spite of our education is deeply ingrained in our psyche. We who repudiate vengeance and eye-for-an-eye retribution are also happy to root for vigilantes in Western films to kill the criminals, or for the Count of Monte Cristo as he takes his just revenge. It was the famed Italian jurist Cesare Beccaria who first asked in 1764 that we consider imprisonment instead of death as punishment for a crime. He argued that this was for the protection of society. His radical proposal helped advance true civilization by abandoning vengeance. Sentences would be calculated in years according to the gravity of the crime. Yet there are still those who debate whether life imprisonment is a just punishment and are indignant to learn that prisoners can watch television. French Minister of Justice Robert Badinter gave us one example of standing up in the face of hostile public opinion when he abolished the death penalty in 1981. This reformer was able to prevail through his higher moral and civil sense. But capital punishment lives on in many nations, including the United States. It is still being massively applied in China. Psychologically, death is viewed as the supreme punishment, instead of being seen as the continuation of a cycle of violence and retaliation. All that is considered retribution makes civilization regress. In acts of war, our greatest regression, we witness the curse of mortal punishment. The death penalty does not consider that a convicted person can be transformed or rehabilitated. To label a human being a criminal by referring only to the crime he has committed means, as Hegel said, ignoring all the other aspects of his life, including context, feeling, and demeanor. We must always favor the possibility of rehabilitation, fully understanding that forgiveness can begin a process of redemption, and even achieve it. Extraordinary humanity emanates from this story, in which Idanna Pucci, Cora Slocomb's great-granddaughter, lends all her sensitivity to the tragic fate of immigrants arriving in America. She also feels deep pride for her activist ancestor and for her family, the Brazzas, one of whom gave Africa its only explorer who respected indigenous peoples and traveled among them as a friend, and after whom Brazzaville is named. Those compassionate ancestors live on in Idanna. This book should awaken in us a deep reflection on the barbarity still present today in our civilization. Edgar Morin, a noted French sociologist and philosopher, is recognized as one of the most prominent interdisciplinary thinkers of the 20th century. He is known especially for his work on complex thought and his contributions to media studies, politics, visual anthropology, ecology, education, and systemic biology. Morin has authored over 60 books. To be against the death penalty doesn't mean being against punishment or in favor of criminal liberties. But in order to punish justly, we must respect certain rules, rules which are the product of a civilized society. The reasons for punishment must be convincing, and above all, there must be absolute proof. Tiziano Terzani, Letters Against the War.
Preface. The pursuit of the past can sometimes seem an adversarial task, in which our opponents precede us by several lifetimes, capitalizing on their advantage, misplacing and destroying clues. Such an adversary is the drunken Austrian soldier sleeping away the night of December 17, 1917, on the enormous Venetian carpet of my ancestral home in northeast Italy. His garrison has occupied the state. Dominated by the ruins of a 10th-century castle, the grounds of Brazzà are laden with snow. Nearby is the chapel, where years later I would be baptized, and where in turn I baptized my doll. Except for the creaking of branches under the white weight, all is silent. The only wakeful presence is the ember of my adversary's cigarette, burning the 18th-century carpet. Soon a terrible fire explodes in the white landscape. It does not spread to the park, but the villa is consumed, and with it, all of Cora Slocomb de Brazzà's possessions. The fire destroys the diaries Cora kept as a child in New Orleans and those she wrote later as a woman of two worlds. Memorabilia is lost. Her portrait as the Queen of Carnival in 1881, her wedding pictures, her correspondence. I was named Idanna after my maternal grandmother, the only child of Cora Slocomb and De Talmo di Brazzà. And until recently, I knew little more about Cora than that she was my great-grandmother. I was born in Brazzà, Italy, near Udine, in the great white villa that was rebuilt after the fire. But I was removed from that enchanted domain and from my mother at an early age. As an old gypsy had predicted, circumstances forced my mother to sail to another continent and abandon everything she loved. Each September, caravans of gypsies migrating south to the Camargue from Hungary would camp for a few nights outside our gate. Hand in hand, my mother and I would hurry out to visit them. The women seemed to belong to a very distant land. I sat quietly beside my mother under the shade of an acacia tree, while she listened as her palms were being read, intent on every word. These occasions provided my first intimations of the wider world, a place made in the image of those transient narrators, mysteriously governed by adventure and destiny. Filled with wonder, I too stretched out my 3-year-old palms to be examined by the old woman. She pronounced her judgment. I would be uprooted as well. The notion of destiny helped me accept my mother's mysterious departure for Africa. In Florence, where I grew up in my father's home near the Duomo, the severance from my maternal side was complete. The oblivion of my great-grandmother Cora was final. Her possessions had burnt, and her name was not mentioned in our household. It wasn't until years later that I reunited with my mother in Switzerland, idly inquired about my American great-grandmother. At first, I encountered secrecy. Cora was mentioned in a whisper, as if a great mystery or sorrow were trapped in the mere utterance of her name. But one day, my mother and I were roaming through her apartment, which was like a family shrine, holding a few relics of life in Brazzà. "That belonged to my grandmother, Cora," Mother said, indicating a porcelain flower vase. "She painted it herself. It's the only one left." The design was of large blossoms, deep red garden-grown roses, on a white background. This was in Brazzà, next to my mother's bed, she said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.